Welcome into a brief look at a teaching session that deals with volatility in behavior at a status boundary. The imagery that I'll invite you to look at in just a moment is one in which someone is vacillating like a yo-yo in their behaviors between arrogance and fear, missing the important points of balance between confidence and humility because they are at a status boundary. They are about to undergo a kind of phase transition in leadership of the kind that you might be confronting now between management and leadership, or in my world, between PhD student and professor. My name is Matt Bothner. I'm professor of strategy here at ESMT. I teach classes of the kind that you're about to have a piece of in the areas of status and organization and in agile leadership. I hope you enjoy what follows and look forward to hearing any feedback, any ideas that you might have. Let's get a sense of what volatility in behavior close to a status boundary looks like. What we have in this diagram here is time, calendar time, moving along the horizontal axis, and then vertically, and importantly, right in the middle of the space, we have this red line. This red line is a line of demarcation between different status grades. On the left side of the line is a lower status grade, on the right side of the line, a higher one. So it's like a phase transition in status, when water, for example, is turning into a gas. So it could be that we've got law school student and lawyer on the right side of the line, or we have manager versus executive, or we have member of a traditional team on the left side, manager of an agile team on the right side. Someone, for the most part, that you would like to bring onto your team in almost all circumstances, this is someone who's going to fluctuate, yes, but very narrowly around confidence. They're not going to be swinging around like a yo-yo. Now, what's interesting is that often when people get close to a status boundary, this is a boundary that they very much wish to traverse, they start to become much more variable, much more volatile. So the person here, getting close to the boundary, might feel that he or she has to overcompensate to make a point very, very powerfully so that the decision makers, as they're about to make this decision, allow him or her to cross the line, that they have enough data to get across the line. But it's really overcompensation. So the person shoots up and engages in some form of arrogance. They think it's going to be helpful. It ends up being harmful. This job candidate gets smacked down and they're now beneath this second dotted line. They're in a zone of fear. They're in a zone of timidity because they've been violently pushed back. Here, regrettably, they may develop a kind of sense of being an imposter. They may feel like a fake, and they may career-wise die there. Hopefully, though, they bootstrap themselves back up. They get across the red line. But even here, after they're on your team, after they've joined your department, they may still exhibit behavioral variability. The person who's just been hired may ask him or herself, why did it take them so long to give me this position? And the pent-up resentment, the self-congratulatory feelings may cause a spike in arrogance. The person may again be pushed down. If they're resilient, they'll bounce back. And in the end, hopefully, there'll be a kind of confidence reset. Now, the ideal is to avoid all of this variance. The problem with variable behavior is that it fuels a multiplicity of stories and brings confusion into the marketplace. So if your goal is to get someone onto your team quickly, you need to be able to smooth out their behavior when you start to sense that they're becoming variable. So an important question that I'd like to put to you now is the following. If you sensed a colleague that you wanted to bring onto your team was starting to act in a variable way, how would you coach him or her before promotion to narrow the range of their behaviors and get them successfully across the red line? So there's a candidate, there's a job candidate whose contributions you deeply need on your team. You're trying to get him or her across the red line, and yet this person's volatility may be killing the opportunity. What can you do? You want to end this yo-yo-like behavior. Let's start with the simple and the obvious. The first step is to refocus the candidate on the objective criteria that have to be met to cross the red line. It may be that in the welter of emotion to make this transition, the candidate has somehow forgotten about the basics that need to be done. Secondly, in addition to producing that forward-looking emphasis on the criteria, you could also help the candidate productively to look back. It may be that as you help the candidate to remember some of the past victories, the past successes, that this will lower the tendency to be so anxious, increase confidence, make it easier for the candidate to get across the line. More subtly, if time permits, if time is permitting, it would be quite useful to put the candidate in contact with other, let's say, executives who are of equal status to those on the side of the red line where the candidate's trying to go, but who are not directly evaluating the candidate. This is a kind of artificial space. This is a space where the candidate can have a sense of the demeanors, the code, the approach that exists on this much higher status grade without being under some kind of a microscope. And so it's a lower stakes yet highly informative environment. If you can get the candidate in that kind of an artificial space, that would be valuable. To give an example, imagine I was working at General Electric and I had someone that I valued a lot within GE Capital before GE Capital gets sold. This friend of mine, this colleague of mine, wants to become, let's say, a chief financial officer within GE Capital, wants to move into an EBAN job. What I might do, if I had the network to do so, would be to take that candidate and put him in contact with executives that are of the same standing, but in the part of General Electric that makes locomotives. That way, the candidate would have a sense of what it's like to be on the other side of the red line, learning the ropes in a lower stakes environment. That can be very valuable. A fourth and final point of discussion with the candidate has to do with where the dotted lines are, specifically the dotted line that provides a kind of breakpoint between arrogance up here and confidence there. It may be that the candidate is from a corporate culture where the dotted line is much higher. Compare, for example, a bank in Frankfurt, Germany, one branch of that bank. Imagine that bank also has a branch on Wall Street. It's possible that the dotted line for the Frankfurt branch is right about here, and yet given the different culture of Wall Street, that dotted line is up towards infinity. If the candidate has moved from the US to Germany, he or she may need a sense of where the dotted line now stands. That could be another very important conversation to have. Corporate cultures differ, of course, within the same company across national cultures. I'd like us next to consider another issue, but a related one, which is, I'd like you to imagine that this candidate that you've onboarded, he or she's gotten across the red line successfully, but not entirely successfully. After having joined, you're starting to catch wind of the idea that he or she is fluctuating again. What would you do to coach him or her after the promotion? This is another very important, very mature leadership question for us to consider. So you're seeing fluctuations again. What can be done about it? I'd like you to consider this very simple process. It has four steps to it, four moments to it. The first is to encourage the candidate to engage in what we'll call semi-public goal setting. And by semi-public goal setting, I mean it's not private goal setting, which might occur on a Sunday afternoon, nor is it very public, as if the candidate is speaking to his or her colleagues with a megaphone. What I mean by this is that the candidate sits down with a couple of opinion leaders that you have selected, who are mature, who care about bringing forward the potential in a young leader. And what the candidate says to these two opinion leaders is the following: I see that I need to grow in this area, and my objective is to do so. And I also discern that I must grow in this area as well, and my aim is to achieve X by such and such a time in this other competence. Now, it's interesting to think about what will happen as a consequence of this, especially as the opinion leaders start to share things with others. One of the most important and very straightforward consequences of this is that the mere act of setting a couple of goals will bring focus to the candidate, focus to the person who's been newly hired. In addition to this, though, the audience, especially as the opinion leaders share the fruits of this conversation, they will start to relax. They will start to see that this is someone they've hired who is coachable. This is someone who's reflective. This is someone who is situationally aware and self-aware. And these factors taken together the sharper focus, the pacified audience will in turn bring about more stable behavior on the part of this person that you've brought onto your team.